So, yeah, so these podcasts are a new phenomenon in the United States, and I was awakened to it by my daughter, who's 38, and I said to her, what's your favorite radio show? And she said, I don't listen to the radio anymore, but I do listen to podcasts because I can take my iPhone with me when I commute to work, and when I'm at home in the internet Wi-Fi environment at home, the app automatically downloads the latest episode of my podcast, and then I put it in my pocket and I go off, and even if I'm in a subway or even if I'm in a dead zone, as we have so many on this island, where there's no nearby cellular internet, you can hear a podcast because it's been downloaded essentially to the storage device of the iPhone. And so we decided to do podcasts as well here. And these are some of our shows. Our icon is at the left and our shows are on the right. And What's Up Bainbridge is a series of episodes, each one of which is about 5 or 10 minutes long, and it tells you about an interesting upcoming local event. Who's on Bainbridge is generally longer, it's 15, 20, 25 minutes, and it's an interview with somebody who makes it interesting and engaging to live on Bainbridge Island. We've interviewed the city manager, the chief of police, a scientist who is an expert on earthquakes, another scientist who's an expert on climate change, a guy who used to be the captain of the ferry between Bainbridge and Seattle, who just retired from that job and now lives on Bainbridge and had many stories to tell. So that's who's on Bainbridge. Community Cafe is, it's like going to a cafe with somebody who's really passionate about an issue, and it's about the needs and issues of the community. We've done some things on the city's comprehensive plan update. Taste of Bainbridge, for an island that's full of foodies, is about food and farming and dining here locally and gardening. Bainbridge Outdoors takes us out of the studio, typically with that Zoom device and a couple of microphones, and we go down to a beach and talk with a birding expert about the incoming migratory birds from the Arctic that come here every November. And Bainbridge on Campus is a set of episodes made by high school students like Jonathan and his friends Finn and Charlie and others.
Usually in the What's Up format.
Yeah, kind of talking about an upcoming event. Our newest show, we got a grant to do this one. It's about art and artists on Bainbridge, especially interviews by the art museum director of artists that are showing in the museum. So people always ask me, how do you hear a podcast? Well, here are four ways. One way is by getting your free app. And I'll pass around this iPad, because what you'll see on the iPad is an icon with BCB and a map of Bainbridge Island. And when you touch the icon, it opens up to a picture of our 8 shows. And from there, you can touch one of the shows and say, I want to see the episodes of that show. And there they are. And that's one way to listen to our programming, either on an iPad or an iPhone or an Android phone. But it turns out that statistically there are about 5 or 6 times as many podcasts listened to on Apple devices than on Android devices.
Mostly because there is a proprietary built-in application that you can see up there called Podcasts on
the
iDevice.
That one. So every iPhone has a podcast app.
With Google, it's a bit more complicated. It technically falls into the music category, into the subcategory. It's complicated. It's not really Android. I don't think they really thought about it. But the BCB app is available on Android. It doesn't look nearly as pretty, I must say. But it is still available. So.
Uh-huh.
Can I ask you a question about that?
Yeah.
How are you building your apps? Is there some tool that provides a template for that that you're using or something like that?
We're very lucky to have decided to place our podcasts onto a commercial platform made by a company called Libsyn, which stores the audio files, which distributes and downloads the audio files from servers that are designed to process big audio files quickly. And because we use that service and pay them by the month, okay. they throw in the apps at no extra charge.
Okay.
And a second way that our programming reaches people is through our own website, Best of BCB. And you see on the right side, this is the most recent set of podcasts. If you click on any of them, it takes you to the podcast page. You get to click a button that says play, and off you go.
Is Libsyn also posting that, I suppose?
Yeah, Libsyn's feeding that. Libsyn is also feeding our Facebook page, and that's another way to listen to our podcasts. We also have friends in the community, like an organization called Quality Bainbridge has a Facebook page, and they said, hey, put your posts on our page too. So there's that. The largest Facebook page on the island is by a group called Bainbridge Islanders. They have about 5,300 members. Some of them are very vocal and speak out in lots of lively and engaging and controversial ways, but they've responded so far to our podcast as well. And a fourth way we do it is through our community's online newspaper called Inside Bainbridge, which is at insidebainbridge.com. They give us a whole page where we do a rotation, where we always have the 10 most recent podcasts showing, so you can listen to them there. The transition to you, yeah.
There's a fifth way, which is through iTunes.
Oh, yeah.
You download it through the podcast section of iTunes.
Yeah, because we use Libsyn, which has been around since the invention of podcasts, they feed directly to the Apple iTunes store, which is the largest collection of podcasts in the world. And so if you type in a search for BCB Bainbridge, lo and behold, our 8 programs pop up amidst hundreds of thousands of others, but you find ours, and then you can play ours. So the transition to what Jonathan wants to show you and another software product that I can show you is to talk about audio. And as I said, back when I was in college in the 60s, and I wanted to edit a public affairs program, it was recorded on reel-to-reel tape. And the way you edited was literally, you put the tape in a groove in a box called an editing block. The editing block, it was like a miter saw box. It had a 45-degree angle cut into it, had a 90-degree angle cut into it. You could take your little razor blade, you literally sliced the tape, you found the part of the tape where the edit needed to be, slid it along, sliced it there, and put the two 45-degree slices together and put a piece of tape across it, a special kind of tape. And that was editing. And today, editing is done on digital devices, typically computers. And I mean, a little story about how it used to be. Back when the Beatles made Strawberry Fields Forever in 1966, John Lennon said, you know, I really like the first half of that song from take number 4, but the second half from take number 6. George Martin, can you put those two things together? The trouble was that this one was recorded a half tone up as a key, and it was recorded slightly slower. So George Martin managed during the 10 seconds leading up to the edit to slow this down gradually, changing its key and changing its pace so that it transitioned to the different take. Today, you can do that electronically, both change the tone and change the pace.
And some programs will do it automatically.
Some would do it in a no-brainer. It took George Martin a long time, and you can still hear that edit exactly 1 minute into Strawberry Fields Forever, 60-second mark. So now we have Audacity, Apple GarageBand, and Apple Logic Pro. At our studio, we use their $200 product, Logic Pro. Some of our volunteers use the free product, GarageBand. And Jonathan's here to show you another free product called Audacity, which has a version that runs on both on Windows or a version for the Mac.